Greetings in the name of the Most High. Well, oh Lord, praise God. It's His Word. It's you know, in the hands of a lot of the Bible experts, it's like the word is not being fulfilled for them the way it is for me, where it just seems that everything I turn to, Daniel 7, 11, and 12, I am naughty. Yes, I had. Weak bum and went for the ice cream last night, but full fat gelato, vanilla bean, very nice. But I think we'll that was then. This is another day. Anyway, just blows my mind. Lord, you are so far beyond. Okay, a couple of things. One, I'm convinced that our Lord, our Savior, Jesus, the whole mystery of the Bible is coming clear in our minds now. It's like we're being infused with the Word of God in the way that God's teaching it, not necessarily how man goes about it. And speaking of Daniel, let me just go there. So the prophecies of Daniel are like steeped in a lot of symbolism, and people throughout the ages have said, well, this means this, you know, they always say it's this time we're in, you know. And they show you this and they show you that historically, and they say that means, you know, from everything from the little horn and to the various kings and so forth and so on. And then we have the kings of the past, which of course is fulfilled prophecy in Daniel, you know, and then, but as it was before, it will be again. But check this out. And the kingdom and the dominion and the greatness of the kingdom under the whole of heaven shall be given to the people of the saints of the Most High. Remember, greetings in the name of the Most High? It's like Daniel here, right? Whose kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and all dominions shall serve and obey him. Hitherto is the end of the matter. As for Daniel, my cogitations much troubled me, I can imagine. And my countenance changed in me, I can imagine. But I kept the matter in my heart. Now, the fourth beast shall be the fourth kingdom upon the earth, which shall be diverse from all kingdoms, and shall devour the whole earth, and shall tread it down and break it in pieces. And the ten horns out of this kingdom are ten kings that shall arise, and another shall arise after them, and he shall be diverse from the first, and shall subdue the three kings, and he shall speak great words against the Most High, and shall wear out the saints of the Most High, and think to change times and laws, and they shall be given unto his hand until a time and times and the dividing of time. It's actually a short time. But the judgment shall sit, and they shall take away his dominion to consume and destroy it unto the end. I have to read it again. But the judgment shall sit, you know, shall be final. It shall stay. And shall take away his dominion, his meaning this one. Another shall rise after them. He shall be diverse from the first and shall subdue the three kings. He shall be the And he shall speak great words against the Most High, and shall wear out the saints of the Most High, and think to change times and laws, and they shall be given into his hand until a time, and times of the dividing of time. That time is about up. But the judgment shall sit, and they shall take away his dominion, to consume and to destroy it under the end, and the kingdom and the dominion and the greatness of the kingdom under the whole heaven shall be given to the people of the saints of the Most High, whose kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and all dominions shall serve and obey him. Now that just about sums her up. And what was I? And I was in Dan, of course, in Daniel 7. We were in the last few verses, Daniel 7, 25, 24, 23. I tend to read the Bible backwards. I don't know why. I just read everything back. I'm kind of dyslexic mentally. So I tend to go from the end to the beginning rather than the beginning to the end. Or from the middle to... Yeah, I'm just like that. I just kind of... I go at something kind of all around it, you know, and through it. But I don't see how you could read that and not have tremendous hope. Now, let's cut to, in our little movie here today, we're going to cut to Revelation 18. I understand, you know, you've been there, done that, but we're going to get there. It's not going to be the same now after Daniel 7. We're going to go to 18, and I'm just going to go to the first verse. And then, now, and I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out of her, my people, that you be not partakers of her sins, and you receive not her plagues. For her sins have reached unto heaven, and God hath remembered her iniquities. Reward her even as she rewarded you, and double unto her double according to her works, in the cup which she hath filled to her double. How much she has glorified herself and lived deliciously, I love to say lavishly. So much torment and sorrow give her. For she saith in her heart, I will sit a queen, and am no widow, and shall see no sorrow. Now, to me, what that is, my interpretation, is it's the attitude of all these revolutionaries, all these people trying to bring this new world in. This is their attitude. This is the queen. She sits a queen and she's no widow. She'll see no sorrow. They're very smug about this. Now, I think you're starting to see a very defined parallel between and a reading between Daniel 7 and Revelation 18. And the kings of the earth who have committed fornication and lived deliciously with her, love that language, shall bewail her and lament her, for they shall see the smoke of her burning, standing afar off, the fear of her torment, saying, alas, alas, the great city Babylon, the mighty city Wall Street, in 1 hour the judgment's come. I mean, it's over. And the merchants of the earth shall weep and mourn over her, and not, well, they'll weep over themselves. And no man shall buyeth her their merchandise anymore. And then it goes into what the merchandise is and winds up with, and one of the items listed, one of the commodities, the last one to be listed is what? The souls of men. Yes, they trade upon in fact, the entire system is powered by the souls of men who have lost their souls, sold out to the world system in exchange for filthy lucre, in exchange for gain. Now, who gets double punishment? All this is just basically showing, it's bridging the New and Old Testament of Bible prophecy for today. You know, I've suddenly become completely locked. I've been just thrown into Bible prophecy. Such a I have no idea what happens day to day around here. I'm just, I was given a revelation. I was given a revelation. For many, oh, I hear the coyotes. Yes, I must be getting on to something good here. For much time, I have been in dread, and I've been tweeting out tweets, you know, about the false flag shootings and, you know, how, you know, Loretta Lynch's incredible, you know, like, I stand with the Muslims and not with the victims, which is just the most treasonous traitor statement ever made by anybody in the whole history of the United States. There's never been a traitor like Loretta Lynch ever that was not either jailed or removed from office, ever, in the whole history of this country. And then I would tweet out Governor George Pataki, you know, the ex-governor, and his great statement of, you know, we need to declare war on Islam, and hello, Loretta Lynch. I'm not going to edge toward saying something violent against Muslims. They need to be killed. Okay, go ahead and arrest me, he says. Now that's cojones. So that's a, I had to admire that man in that incident. I mean, that's one of the greater moments of George Pataki that I've ever seen. So I guess Loretta Lynch is bringing the, you know, if there are good men out there, she's bringing the best of, you know, he's not a coward. My God, seeing not a coward in the United States, I'm amazed. Because you see, the entire world system, everybody that seeks to change the laws, and Obama is, of course, I mean, are we reading about him or what? Are we reading about the United Nations or what? Are we reading about world events here or what? As a friend of mine said, you know, Zeph, it's hard to predict when, you know, the timing, but we'll know it when we're in it. We'll know it when we're in it. I used to say the end goes on a long time. Well, when I said a long time, I meant, you know, years. It may not come the year you say it. And it may not come by 2018. A nice wrap up with a bow and the return of Jesus on the East Gate on Rosh Hashanah, you know. But another thing, for my friends that have been mad at me because they think I'm too much of a Zionist, well, I'm sorry I can't change the way I am. You know, I see the United States and Israel and these various nations beyond what you see, beyond the corrupt evil. I mean, if you had to say which is the most evil between, say, the Vatican, the United States right now, which is and Israel, I would say the United States is probably the most evil nation that has ever been on the face of the earth, under the surface. I mean, if you could see, like I've been shown, like Ezekiel, you could see through those doors, and we should go to Ezekiel too, through those doors, if you could see them behind closed doors, you could see how the world works, you could see them in the back rooms, you could see how all this stuff gets divvied up, you could see how, you know, all the plans of these men. Really, it's very simple to sum it up. It's all, everything they do is that which is against God, dot, dot, dot. You know, I've always said that to you. That which is against the Bible. So if they didn't believe in God in the Bible as the superior book to the Quran or to the Lotus Sutra or to the whatever, to all the various other holy books out there, if they didn't believe the Bible was the most superior of all, they wouldn't change laws and times and things that had to do with the Bible. They would go at another book. They go directly at the Bible. All of this is a war against God, but it's also a war against the Bible. And I just, and watching it, and then using the government's creating ISIS, which is, you know, this whole thing that just happened, this shooting. I mean, I've tried to keep my powder dry, but it's pathetic. I mean, did you buy that, really, that just independently this just went on and is all wrapped up like a nice, neat bow. No, you didn't. You knew there was collusion. You know it's ISIS. And what is ISIS? You know, what is it? It's a tool of the Western powers to bring about this New World Order, right? This is their army. And then, so whenever people, they go, ISIS says that they didn't do anything on the orders of ISIS. They were inspired by ISIS. ISIS cheers them on, but they were not part of ISIS. Wrong. They were all. It's all part of the same thing. It's all ISIS. It's dictated by the governments. They dictate and handle these people and then get them to go shoot up the place or whatever, and then they kill off the witnesses and get those vehicles impounded so you don't find out those are Fed vehicles, and you know what I mean? And wrap it all up and clean it all up nice like nobody did anything wrong. And then Obama comes out and makes his statement, right? Proxy, everything by double deception. Now, I don't want to go into it. Well, you got to admit God is blessing us because, you know, we had this ISIS thing and we also had the counter to ISIS here at the Zephyr Report long before anybody else did in terms of, not that it was funded, but the handling and the filmmaking and the, you know, the real tight inner collusion, the tight network of ISIS interfaced with especially the United States government, and in particular, Obama's own little private army. I mean, he wanted his million-man army, and it looks like ISIS is the one he was building, but now he got caught with his hand in the cookie jar, and you can see there's a real conflict, and he goes back and forth. Again, the problem you have with Obama is that he is very unstable, so he stabs in the back all the people he makes deals with. Like, he'll make a deal with Putin, then he'll shoot his planes down. He'll make a deal with, say, the Pope, and then he'll do something against the Catholics. He'll, you know what I mean, with regard to whatever, forcing Catholics to take birth control pills or something to that effect. He'll make a deal with, whoever he makes a deal with, he betrays them. This is something exclusive to today's podcast, exclusive in all the world. It's something that I have, very subtle, because it's not been in the news, but I have picked up on it, that he's a betrayer of his own. Hence, he has sown the seeds of his own destruction, hence Daniel 7. And I have the feeling, I mean, you know, maybe I'm wrong, and I leave room to be wrong. I'm inspired by, you know, the prophets and the Bible and everything, but, you know, I know how, you know, and as soon as you put a label on it, a timing on it, you know, there's disappointment. But it sure feels, and this may be the social planners trying to make me feel this way, but it sure feels like I'm watching Bible prophecy right now unfold. And all of it, and you're going to love this podcast by the time you get to the end of it. It's going to be delicious for you, not delicious for the, it'll be bitter to the world. Because you see, I talk to worlders around here in New Mexico that, you know, claim it's easier to be with the world system and you're a fool's F and blah, 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 you know, that sort of, well, it can get serious to where they just come to kill you, I suppose. You know, there's also a pile of bodies there of people who have tried that. You know, the Lord protects his lambs. That's all I can say. I don't want people to die or get hurt or lose their jobs or lose their families or whatever. But, I mean, you know, it's like people, when you take on God by picking on his children, you know, there's retribution on you. In fact, this entire thing with the United States right now is it's like a softball lob. It's all about the Lord's retribution against the United States. So here I'm standing on pretty firm prophetic ground with many that have come before me who have said the same things about America. So I am standing on that very firm, sure word ground when I say that America is a satanic nation, not a Judeo-Christian nation at all. That was the double deception. That was sown in the very beginning through the Luciferian Freemasons, and Lucifer is obviously Satan. So, you know, that this has all been the old Jacobins of the French Revolution are right here destroying the United States, because the whole plan now is to sacrifice the United States on the altar of the New World Order, which, of course, is nothing new and will not be achieved, because before they ever see anything, and they won't, they will see their own destruction, and they will. And that you can take to the bank. Already, the seeds of confusion, and we saw this, you know, months ago with the Pentagon, you know, having various spokesmen say contradictory statements about what the Pentagon will do regarding ISIS. It was hilarious. You should have been there. I told everyone to watch it, to watch for it, but again, very few people really hear what's going on here. There's sometimes the Lord gives instructions to his people, you know, through me, let's say, in this case, that you need to, you know, pay attention to, so that when these little signs come, that you know you've been ministered to by the Lord himself. And then that boosts your faith and makes you a stronger person in this time where strength is kind of hard to find. So let me just get to what this time is. So I got a revelation. It was very, very, very subtle and sublime, and it came over me just about 2.5 hours ago. And it was like, son, why are you fretting so much about the world and about these awful things that, you know, how are you so frustrated that you can't, you're calling them as you see them, you know, you see the corruption in all these shootings, and you see, and then nobody can hear you because they all think you're a conspiracy whack job when you say anything like that. You say New World Order, or if you say false flag attack, or you say the government and ISIS, or Hollywood and ISIS, that makes you look like, you know, Mel Gibson and Conspiracy Theory. I mean, you know, you look, the world is just thinks you have written people like you off, and they're just going on enjoying themselves, lavishing themselves endlessly in their lifestyles with their movies and their records and their, and whatever it is they've got going on. You know, I always think of entertainment as, seems like most people are consumed with entertainment, which is like hypnosis, right? Which is sports and music and movies and television and so forth. I was talking yesterday about the memes and movies. We have three main memes. We have the one which is the dystopian future, which is like pounding it in, right? Pounding it in into our consciousness that's inevitable. And then you have this superheroes, right? The Marvel Comics thing, which eventually they'll offer you through altering of the DNA, which will be the how you get written out of the Lamb's Book of Life. We don't see that here right now. So, I mean, we know there's some time here. We see that the United States has been changing laws and times based on the Bible, based on God's wisdom, and enshrining and putting up on the altar things which are an abomination to God, whether it be, you know, gay marriage or any of the rest of it. I mean, these are abominations. I mean, the idea that there'd be a sacred union and some kind of a using the Bible to marry two of the same sex in a holy wedding in a church is absolutely the abomination of desolation, is it not? Or a form of it, anyway. It's an abomination to God. If it were not an abomination to God, times and laws would not be changed regarding it. If it is an abomination to God, then they will do everything in their power to focus in on it to make sure that becomes the law of the land. It's a reaction to the Bible, period, which proves that not only is God real, but the entire New World Order is based on God and the Bible. the antithesis of course. But not based on the Quran, not based on the, like I say, the Lotus Sutra or the Mahabharata or various, you know, Sumerian mythological and sacred texts. Nothing like that at all, or Egyptian religion or Tibetan Buddhism or anything like that. It's based on the Bible. The New World Order. Satanism is based on the Bible.
Well, Satanism was around a long time before the Bible.
Yes, but it's all based on that. I mean, if you know anything about witchcraft or witches, it's even if they don't know they're doing it, it's all the ritual, all the things they do, all the abominations that they try to force people to do as normal, which is witchcraft 101. It's all that which is against God. They don't realize that, but there's real power in that, right? Proving the power of the Lord all the way. So you know you've got the right way, and you know you've got the right book, the Bible, and you know you've got the right one, the Lord, Jesus, because everything in this entire world is lined up against that. And even in places where there are other religions, like Eastern religions and stuff, it's all lined up against the Lord. The kings and the leaders of the world conspire against the Lord. They don't conspire against Krishna. They don't conspire against Buddha. They don't conspire against Muhammad. Sorry, but it's not. It's that they conspire against the Lord. You know, but I don't want to talk about, you know, commercial surfacey religions. I'm just saying that if you want to know how I learned, you know, intellectually, who the actual God is, it's by the reaction of the world to it. You see, when I want to find out what reality is, I simply go to what are people most hateful of? And then there I find my answer, the truth. It's the truth they don't like. It's the light they don't want. And that's what the Bible says in the first chapter of John. Understand that chapter is very deep and says that the man will not comprehend the light. See, the light and the truth and the true light are all the same thing. And they go to war against it. Not any of the other religious icon, nothing. You say, well, Jesus is a myth. Well, there's if he's a myth, why all this money, effort, and even all the mythology about the earth and the mind control and the false information about the universe and the what's out there and what the earth really is and all that, the attack on the Bible, why then focus so much on it? If it's patently false and just another myth, why not just relegate it to they don't line up against these other myths that are like Jesus or Isis and Osiris or whatever the and the rest of the icons out there that are, you know, the various Buddha stories of the three temptations. They're not lining up against Buddha. They're not lining up against all the mythological figures in Egyptian religion or Sumerian religion. They're it's all about Jesus. Then why if these people are so smart and they own everything and they're the social engineers and they're plotting the future to become immortal and all that, why is it all about Jesus then? By CERN, by these scientists, why is it all focused in and around the Bible then? If the Bible is false, like all these other books are just myths, and the Bible is just a myth like that, then why focus in on it? Because, I mean, obviously, there's more Muslims in the world now than Christians, so why focus in on that? Why not focus on the Quran more or something else? No, they don't do that, do they? And what does that tell you, ladies and gentlemen? It tells you that the real truth is what they would align against, because their world, their New World Order, is all about a lie, to get people to believe a lie about their world, about themselves, and so forth. And all the propaganda, all the focus on white people, it's not white people they want, it's the white Christian male, which was the dominant number of people here of old. They say they're all racist. But it's not the racism, it's because of the Christian thing. There's a certain composite type. He's American, he believes in God and country. You know, it's that archetype that they're after to kill. It goes back again to Jesus, not to race.
They say race, but it's not about race. It's about Jesus. It's about that. Because the very same people will tell you they're pro-abortion, and the very same people will tell you they're Satanists when you really press them. You know what I mean? Like, I remember that I saw something from InfoWars where it said they caught people that were, they were doing some racial thing. But what they really were communists. And then what they really were deep down were Satanists, of course, because all communists are Satanists. And even if they believe in nothing, you know, they're still Satanists, which they, because they're basing their entire life around that which is against God. So that makes them a Satanist. It's, do you see reality here? Do you see what has come forth in the Zaref report today? Oh man, you got to save this for the, this one's, if I stop right now, I should quit while I'm ahead, right? Because this was like, gee, I wish I heard this. No, I'd like to tune in and listen. This is the kind of stuff I need to hear. This is the kind of stuff that feeds me today. You know, when we prove everything is right, when we prove all is right, that everything is right with us, when we prove that, yes, we knew all along, and but now the way you put it, I see it very clearly. It's everything is focused on Jesus, the whole world. Right? It's right, or they wouldn't bother making laws about gay marriage. Right? There wouldn't even be an issue. It wouldn't even come up in conversation. Right? Oh yeah. No, it's the idea of putting a same-sex couple in the holy place and conducting a marriage ceremony. That's, and then getting people to be okay with it. That's the delicious. See, if you understand what I understand, oh boy! And if I was on the other side, that would be orgasmic for me. Because I know what it means. See, they don't know what it means. The sheeple out there, they just go, oh, you're gay marriage, I'm for it, yeah. And let's go to the gay wedding. Oh yeah, it's great. And it's like I've told you, people. It's a farce because. Again, if it had nothing to do with the Bible, it wouldn't even matter. It's, people would just do whatever they do, you know? I mean, there'll always be gay people and people that are, for whatever reason, there's going to be, you know, trannies, there's going to be gay people, there's going to be sinners, there's going to be criminals, there's going to be all kinds of... I know you don't want me to lop gay people in with criminals. You want me to say it's normal. Well, the thing is that then show me someone that wasn't terribly abused... who went gay because all my friends that went gay, they had a pretty hard time when they were kids being buggered and all. And, you know, unfortunately, a lot of them are dead now because they went down to West Hollywood and, you know, were go-go boys. And, you know, they don't live that long. It's really sad. I don't know if you know much about the whole gay thing, what happens to people, but I have known quite a few, and you know, it's including ones struggling with Christianity and trying to figure it out, and it's just it's my heart goes out because it's a really tough thing. Not one of these, everyone that I knew, you know what I mean? They're all super politically active, super left-wing, and all they could talk about was politics. The West Hollywood gay boys that did something. I mean, I know screenwriters and all kinds of people, musicians, artists, whatever, you know, are in all in the arts. But of course, they're all in the arts, yeah. Well, anyone can go gay. I mean, you know, it's really not a big deal. You know, the thing is like all of this stuff. I don't want to get distracted with this gay thing. I'm sorry. You know, this is just a digression. The point is, it's getting into that church where they have a Bible and a preacher or a priest, someone to do the holy ritual. And to have people throwing rice and all this stuff about the happy couple in the church setting, the abomination, right? And what is it that's going on there? It's a satanic ritual.
And that's why I said it would be orgasmic for me if I was on the other side, because I know what it is. And I'd be going, oh, God, they don't even know. Oh, boy, yeah, this is really wild. We're getting them to eat their own flesh. It's like the Hannibal Lecter when he starts, he's got the Ray Liotta guy there. He's got his brain opened up. He's got him anesthetized. And he's cooking pieces of his brain and feeding them to him. That is exactly the perfect satanic ritual. Feeding ourselves our own flesh with us being unwitting about it. Feeding ourselves abomination rituals with us being, you know, lost in space somewhere. We're down with it because we don't like the Bible. We don't like God. Don't like it in those things. And we're going to overturn them for freedom and for equality and fairness and beauty and unity. And everything that's being done is for love and equality and fairness and unity and social justice. Everything. But every single thing is tied to the Bible. Why is that? Because the Bible is true. That's why. Not tied to Sumerian this or that or this other, all the prototypes of Jesus stories or virgin birth or whatever. It's Jesus. It's the Lord God, Yahweh. It's the Creator. That's why you can have a great deal of confidence in the Word. People say, well, you said the Word is not the inerrant. I'm not saying the Bible is perfect from a technical standpoint, but the Word is kind of more than just what's written in the Bible, right? It's an event. But you can rely on the Word of God, starting with the Bible, yeah. Even Romans 13, the way I break it down, that I say, you know, the government comes from God. If you have an evil government, it's a reflection, in other words, of the people. You know, we got the government we deserve right now here in America. We deserve this government and these laws to be, in times of being changed. The satanic ritual is going for abomination of desolation is on full, I mean, the ultimate goal, of course, is, you know, standing in the holy place and proclaiming yourself God, that man is really God. And that's what they do every day. They in various ways, they do it. That's what the New World Order is all about. The whole thing is an abomination to God. If there wasn't a Bible and God wasn't true or anything, it would have a whole different format. Think about it. A whole different kind of texture and context to it. It would not be that social formation if there wasn't a Bible. In fact, everything about the New World Order is biblical and proves that God is who they know to be God and they're at war with. If they're at war with some god of some other thing, a Buddha somewhere, or a Bodhisattva over here somewhere, or something like that, well, then it would be based on that. But it isn't. It's based on Yahweh. And then they go, yeah, but the real thing is that Yahweh is really Saturn. So they got you double-double. Do you see? You're not getting out of this one. So yes, I am getting out of this one because I don't worship the created, which is what Saturn is. My creator created Saturn along with every other thing. So no, when you say that Yahweh is a created thing, then you're going against the whole nature of I am that I am. Therefore, you are an idiot and illogical. And you're probably, if I'm not mistaken, you're lost. You're one of the people that I'm ministering to today who feels really bad about everything. Because, sir, you have no faith. You put your faith in your own intellect. And you got this thing where Jesus is cool, but Yahweh is really Molech or something. I went down that path, I saw all this crap, and I saw the text that says Yahweh is really Molech, you know, and it doesn't prove anything. The creator is not the created, and I rest my case on that. Saturn is created, you know, my God, I am, is not created, it's everlasting, is eternal, and forever was and is and will be, and is the creator. So for some reason, if he created Saturn, well, he's got a reason for that. If you want to go worship Saturn or the hexagram on Saturn, go ahead. I doubt that even exists, actually.
I actually even doubt, you know, when we get into, you know, this whole thing about planets and what's out there, right now it's all in doubt. You know, the Lord is showing us that we've been lied to our whole lives about a lot of things, including the cosmos. I'll just let it sit right there. Yeah, but Zeph, aren't you really against the Zionists? I don't make that distinction. You know that but Israel's evil. They blew up the towers. They did this. They hurt the Palestinian children, which are Christians. They do all this terrible stuff. I'm not looking at that. If there's corruption in Israel, what else is new? You got anything new for me? It shouldn't have been formed. It was an Illuminati formation to begin with. It's part of the New World Order. It's the Jew World Order. And the whole thing is Jewish. And they're not even real Jews. The real Jews I've got people out there, they're putting up videos about how the real Jews are the black people. The blacks are the real Jews, the chosen, and no one else is. And I'm right there, I'm just like, oh my God. I don't want to deal with all these sideshows, okay? I'm not going to deal with any of you. Any is. You know, the Lord will deal with Israel. So, well, Israel is really the people. Oh, okay, well, you want to go symbolic with everything. That's fine. But we live in a world where, you know, there are things that do exist. And Syria is one, and Israel is one, and Egypt is one, and the things do exist. I mean, you know, so it can't just be symbolic. So I'll continue down my path, you know, which is, I feel I've treaded pretty carefully. I mean, I've gone into, you know, a lot of spiritualizing of everything, you know, and looking at this, you know, it may be a simulacra of sorts because real reality is eternal, but it's our simulacra. It's God's simulacra. You know what I mean? So we have to take it seriously. You know, yes, there's a matrix, but that's a satanic rite and satanic initiation, a rite of passage. And when people go through that rite of passage, they go into the matrix, which is a double deception. And we're going to talk about that right now, what's going to happen to these people. And I just, you know, I had to kind of warm up to this because it's really heavy. This is going to be a paradigm changer, ladies and gentlemen. So strap in. Get ready because the plane is taking off. The spaceship's taking off. We're going out the dome and into the throne of God here, like Enoch. The Lord said, and I quote, "This is a time of rejoicing for my people. Because you see, the justice that you have long waited for all the crimes they've done against you and the people who have no voice today, is being addressed right now by the Lord God in the judgment of America and other places, wherever you happen to be out there, whatever country you happen to be in." It's like, yeah, you know, oh no, let's just a second now. This is one of the heaviest things you're ever going to hear, because see, God is demanding that you flip your attitude 180 degrees into seeing how he is rescuing you. He's avenging you, yes, but he's adjudicating the situation as the great judge. He's backing up his children. You see, the whole thing that's going on in the United States isn't about them doing abominations. It's about God's children. Now, those people that have listened here who are into, you know, the gay marriage and they take issue, I'm not even dealing with it on the level that you're seeing it. So you're wrong to attack me. Oh, see, it's a gay, there's not a proof of gay. Right. You've got a peanut brain, and you've been completely thoroughly mind controlled. You drank down all the Kool-Aid, and you think that you're going, again, let me show you who you are. Who the Americans are that have been bullying you. Okay, you ready for this? Check this out. "How much hath she glorified herself and lived deliciously,
so much torment and sorrow give her, for she saith in her heart, I sit a queen and am no widow, and shall see no sorrow. Therefore shall her plagues come in one day, death and mourning and famine, and she shall be utterly burned with fire, for strong is the Lord God who judgeth her, the judge. This is what we're talking about, Revelation 18. This is the great judge. God is a judge. We try to set our courts and our laws up, you know, in reflection of God. So in that, you're seeing that finally, at long last, after so many, I don't know how many centuries, but after a long period of time, God is finally judging this queen. The queen exists in the heart of the satanic world system. You meet the queen and bow down when you pass on through to the other side. Now, everyone knows this. This queen, or based on like the queen of heaven, or the queen of this, or the queen of that, Isis is the queen. You know, there's various times when we have queen. Mary becomes the queen to some Catholics. But the queen is something in another dimension that everyone sows to in exchange for collective spoil robbed from innocents who get crushed by the world system, who mean no one any harm. But unfortunately, the world system exists because of the, death and destruction that it wields on innocent people. It thrives on the blood of innocents. That's why the Maze Runner series is so good, because it's based on the blood of innocents. It's based on the age-old story. So the people that have, you know, sold out into this, and, you know, they're kicking their heels up, they got rid of God, they got the gay marriage thing going, they got all these, there's a bunch of other things they want to change as well, according to the Bible. So they're not interested in changing something that isn't, you know, it's got to be something that God really, you know, like, for example, the push for, you'll see a push for, you know, open marriages, let's say, because God says no adultery, you know, or a push for murder to be okay in a certain context when it's politically motivated, like this last shooting. Our hearts go out to the Muslims who were misunderstood and who were brave and did their thing. They're the ones to need to be protected, not the victims. See, that's an abomination unto God, right? Because it's saying murder is justified in that case. That's what Loretta Lynch is, in fact, you know, saying in a symbolic manner. She's saying, those murders are okay. You know, I will prosecute anyone that criticizes these Muslims for doing what they have to do and for not understanding why murder in their case is okay. So she's changing our laws, right, and saying that murder in this case is okay. And then if you have a loved one that was gunned down here and you're mad about it, she might prosecute you. So that's what she's saying. She's saying that in this case, murder is okay. In other words, let's see another one. Love the Lord God with all your heart, mind, and soul, blah, blah, blah. Okay, so when you hate God, you know, you go up in this world, right? So it's another institutionalized abomination. The hatred of God is an abomination. How do we know how to hate God? They use the Bible to find out how to hate God. How do you hate God? By instituting laws of political correctness and therefore institutionalizing the hatred of God, which is the main goal. You know, it's not the white male Christian, it's the Christian part that they want to prosecute. And yes, if they can wheel out the guillotines that is rumored to be stashed somewhere and get the program going and en masse eliminate everyone that doesn't agree, because we all have to agree or we can't have a world here. I mean, that's the way the left rolls, you know that. I mean, they're the intolerant left, of course, because tolerance is of God. So it would be that which is against God, which would be intolerance, no freedom, total slavery, total mind control, total perversion, total abomination of God, you know, everywhere you look. Institutionalized and enforced by political correctness, that would be the Satanist wet dream right there. Well, they've got that in place right now. And now the blood is starting to flow. But notice how people that are part of the system seem to be the victims in this case, because if they were armed there, there would be no shooting. What does the president do? He comes out and says, I'm going to take the guns so that you will be shot and behave like these people did. When they come to shoot you, you'll just be like a sheep. We don't want you to be able to defend yourselves. What we want is you to be victims of our rule, because we run ISIS and we run all the shootings and we run everything you see. It's all staged and it's all about getting your soul, forcing you to comply, forcing you to make a decision upon death, overwhelming the saints. Now, where is that? That's in Daniel 7. You go back to Daniel 7, what do we see? We see, let me just flip back there real quick. And I get there pretty quickly this way. And, well, there's more to Daniel 7. This is about today. And and he shall speak great words against the Most High and wear out the saints of the Most High. You know, because it looks today like, you know, the terrorists have won. We have no president. I mean, we have a guy that just basically is, he's for every abomination that there is, he's for it. Who even stabs in the back his own people. So, you know, it's just very, very satanic, as you know. And so there he is going about it. And, you know, it's pretty obvious that it's a judgment against the people of this country. Because it was founded, the country became the most powerful country in all the world, excelled to the very top of the food chain, to even be considered to be Mystery Babylon, where all commerce flows from and to. The most innovative, the most everything. But to whom much is given, much is expected. But the people turned against God in their institution. I mean, you know, part of it was letting them into education, to educate the kids, and the kids grew up, and everyone's, you know, the Bible is the problem. The Bible is the problem. The Bible, no other book. It's only the Bible. That's the only book. It's only Jesus, you know, the Bible, and now it's being eradicated. And, you know, you got Rick Warren and other people that are ready to roll out the ecumenical, interfaith sort of Chrislam thing, along with, you know, Buddha, throw Buddha in there and Hinduism, and have this whole kind of one world religion. And they're working on that to roll that out. That's right around the corner. And it's all in preparation, you know. Every single thing has to do with that which is against God. That which is against God. Well, we knew, we've had Rick Warren's number for a long time. Obama had him there to say the prayer to kick off the presidency, if I'm not mistaken, or something, right? The invocation, right? He had Rick Warren. You'd think he'd have a black guy or something, you know, do the race thing. Whatever. But no, it was. So that's how you know that you start saying, well, what is Rick Warren? You're going to get Franklin Graham in on that too, probably. He's pretty conservative. He may not, you know, go for it. But then he'll have to make it. You know, it's funny. Christians that have been in the world system, the satanic Christians, who've kind of done it the world's way and, you know, kind of cooperate like the world does and interact with the world the way the world wants them to and are conformed to the world, yet they're big-time preachers and they're talking about Christ and talking about how we're separate and all that. A bunch of rubbish, right? But those people are all going to be brought to reform. They're going to be brought to a date of decision. They're going to actually have to repent. You know, or join the ecumenical thing. I mean, it's going to come to, so for everybody's going to have to be brought, every single person in this whole earth is going to have to be brought to a public decision. You know, you're either with Satan or against him. And, you know, their attitude is, you know, kill everyone who isn't with him. And when you see that, ladies and gentlemen, you know that this is not the kind of thing you want to join. People like this are horrible. I know I've been, you know, I've known them all my life, and they love to get somebody, you know, isolated. And they love to then humiliate them and make them a laughingstock and tease them and, you know, pretend to be their friend and pretend to try to help, only to set them up like the movie Carrie. And they live for that sort of thing, you know, and that, and it's also interdimensional, that sort of thing. Most people that, you know, well, that's another argument. But this, all this has to do with is God and the holy warring angels coming to the rescue of the saints who have been worn out. And that's the point I'm trying to make. The saints have already been worn out. They're worn out already. You know, killing the more of them or the remnant. There's a remnant here, obviously, that has been already worn out. All the ones I know, they're beleaguered. They're hurting. They're struggling. They're depressed. They feel lost. They feel unloved and unwanted, and they feel like some other category of citizen that they're not even counted. There's such a low on the caste system of classes that their pain is not heard, but they're like a free target to go pick on, where everybody else's rights are protected, but not them. That's how they feel. That means they're worn out. They're overrun. Many have become shut-ins, the Lord's people. Many don't even know anymore that they're lambs of God. They think they're just rejects of the world rather than beloved of the Lord. How did that happen? It's because the church system is corrupt and told them they were otherwise. I know one person that they said she was evil, and that the Lord doesn't want her. When she was just a lamb. In other words, she was not really going to be conforming into their system. So she's evil. So she's of Satan. During the Salem witch trials, they would burn lambs at the stake rather than witches, thinking that, oh, you've got to understand how this works. Oh my God, you don't even know evil, how bad it really gets. Anyway, in this world, you see, the problem, the reason Obama has to come out today and speak is because his team are feeling shaky. His people are feeling shaky. His lieutenants are feeling shaky. They're starting to really understand that there's going to be a big bloodbath here and that they might go down in it. And that wasn't the deal they made. They were going to play, have their weddings, have their parties, and have their, you know, their free money from the government or whatever. They were going to have this nice life where everyone's equal, and you know, nobody's offending anybody else, and no Bible, no God to bother you. But all the other religions are fine. But see, no God, no Bible proves to me that God and the Bible are the thing, or they wouldn't base their entire lives on it. Now, you got to get that through your thick head right now. We have proven, we have proof that the Bible and God of the Bible and Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and life, but primarily right now, for all intents and purposes, the truth. Otherwise, they wouldn't base the entire New World Order on it. They don't base it on any other thing. That's all they base it on. So if it's so insignificant and such a myth, Mr. Jordan Maxwell and the rest of you haters, well, then answer why it's the centerpiece of the satanic system of law, of Congress, of war, of science, etc., etc., and on down the line. You can't. You've never really considered that in the way I'm talking about it. You can't. Because you see, unless you could dismiss it as a myth, where, I mean, you'd think that people that hate God and, you know, don't like Jesus, they would just kind of forget about it and do their own thing. Nope. Every one of them is doing that which is against God. That which is against God of the Bible. That which is against the Bible. That which is against the Word of God. Why that if it's all rubbish? If they're so advanced and progressive and beyond all this silliness of religion, why base their entire religion on the Bible and God? Why? You see, when I did the math on that one many years ago now, not that I needed to do this to prove it to myself, but once I did the math on that, you know, it really became very clear who God is and what God thinks of the Bible and what God thinks of his son, Jesus Christ. I mean, it's pretty clear to me that that's the center of the entire thing. Regardless of how much they try to push it away, they bring it all the closer because they base everything on it. Every witch that I've ever met, it's that. What are the spells they do? Well, the spells are always that which would be harmful to you. That which would be the thing you don't want is the thing they're going to want you to have your nose rubbed in, right? In other words, and then, of course, on a bigger scale, if you're a Christian, then they want to bring you to the dark side. What's the dark side? What do you do? You renounce the God, not just any God, the God of the Bible. That's who you renounce. They go, well, that's because Satanism is stuck in the same mythology. That's why it's Western. It's dualistic thinking. Whether it's monistic or dualistic, or triistic, it doesn't matter. Every culture bases their entire thing on that which is against God. And ironically, where the Bible is not prominent in some of these cultures, it's interesting how they have also changing laws and times to be that which is against God of a Bible that they don't have in their culture. But it's still the same kind of thing. That's just Western mythology, Zeph. It's just Western mythology. It's, you know, outside the United States, people really don't think about Jesus or God or any of that stuff. Well, then why did they base their entire culture on it? Why are there Freemasons everywhere you go in the world? China, India, Indonesia, why? Why is everything in Indonesia based on that which is against God? Why not base it on that which is against Ganesh or something? That which is against Krishna. That which is against the Bhagavad Gita. That which is against the sutras. That which is against the bodhisattvas. That which is against Mahayana Buddhism. That which is against Hinayana Buddhism. That which is against Zen Buddhism. That which is against Jainism. That which is against the Sufis. That which is against the Quran. That which is against Muhammad. That which is against whatever. No, that's not at all it. And nothing is based on that which is against any of those things I mentioned. That which is against Sumerian, ancient Sumerian religion, or Zoroastrianism. Oh, I can go on and name them all. I was a student. I have not forgotten my education, unlike a lot of people. I'm intensely interested in social structures, in mythology. And, you know, I was a devout reader of That Which Is Against God, Joseph Campbell, trying to make everything a myth so that all religious books and texts and myths and everything were equal, which is really to do what?
to prove to go that what was that with Joseph Campbell? That which is against God. What is Star Wars? What was George Lucas's biggest influence? Joseph Campbell, Hero with a Thousand Faces, right? When he was at USC. Yes? You know, does anyone know what I'm talking? No, really, you don't know Hero with a Thousand Faces? That's required reading when you get into college, and that's how they make you an atheist. They make you believe that every religion's equal, and they're all equally true or all equally false. They could put confusion about the whole thing, so you become very... What do you do after reading Joseph Campbell? You become secular. All people are religious beings. And then you, if you really get exotic, you can start studying deeper into it. You can go to, there's various structural sociologists and anthropologists and people. You could study Mircea Eliade, who was one person I got deep into. The classic book that he wrote was called The Sacred and the Profane, which proves that everything, man is homo religiosus. In other words, he basically is going to do, you know, left to his own devices, he would create his own shrines and his own what's profane and what's sacred. He would delineate in his home. He will have a hearth that will be the sacred, the symbolic altar, or the center of the universe, or the center of the world. That if you took a bunch of people and put them on an island, they would come up with a religion based on the various structures that we see in the other religions. Therefore, dot, dot, dot. And of course, he, Eliade, like, you know, and he's passed on now. I mean, but he was a young, handsome guy running around the world. You know, you see him in his Hindu outfits and, you know, trying on the various garb of all the religions. And another guy that was the son of a doctor we had in Beverly Hills. And his son went off to the University of Hawaii and became a professor of comparative religion there. And you would see him with all these various outfits on. He's got to be pretty old now. I mean, probably retired. But, I mean, he would wear all these different, like, outfits, you know, for the Jews or the Hindus or the this or that. But always with a bent toward the east, of course. They all have a bent toward the east. Just like Eliade, who would have been an influencer of this man, would be, you know, basically... they all get enamored with the East and with the pilgrimages and the asceticism and then this being a sannyasin and, you know, the ashrams and the gurus and the, you know, the path. They call it the razor's edge, you know, finding that path, you know, reading the Upanishads and the original Sanskrit and translating Sanskrit text of the Vedas. And, oh, you could get deep into it. And they all went that way, yes. And then the other religions are kind of like add-ons, right? It's really that which is the fascination. And it was true for me as well. I mean, I admit it. I did the same thing. I studied all of that and the sacred texts and Sanskrit. And, you know, I felt I just wanted to move to somewhere like India or, you know, whatever. I just wanted to go there and just, you know, abandon anything that had to do with the world and just... I wanted to be a sannyasin too, you know. A sannyasin is a renunciant, a person that renounces the world. I'm a perfect candidate for that, you know. And there's plenty of kids that are confused from here, from the United States, that went to the ashrams of India to be taken advantage of course, and have their trust funds lifted by their, back in the day when there were trust funds, lifted by their gurus. And some would give everything they had to the guru, like, I've met a lot of people here in New Mexico that came from Rajneesh, and they would give him everything. I met a guy from Italy who basically, you know, he had his own little hut or something there in Pune, India. And, you know, the ashram was in Pune, India, and they had one in Oregon. Of course, that's the famous, you had the Rolls Royces, if you recall, back in the 80s. And they were all armed to the teeth, which shows you something, doesn't it? Supposed to be so peaceful. Why are they all armed? Supposed to be so non-materialistic. Why all the Rolls Royces? Hypocrisy. Yeah, so things did not quite add up for the old Bhagwan, you know. And the poor kids that they gave all their money and all their, you know, they gave up their educations and all their pursuits. Because, see, my theory is most of these people, I met them here.
in Santa Fe. I met quite a few of them. They're not lambs. Yeah. They do the magic go-go thing. You know, they're not really, right? They got the little thing going on. Yeah. I don't know why. So perhaps people that are not really happy with the world system are running over there for hoping to become separated from it. I don't really know, because they're not lambs, really. Lambs know who they are. They're the pure hearts who see God. And they're usually targeted for no reason. Usually it appears to be for no reason, because they don't understand, because they're pure hearts. If they weren't a pure heart, they'd understand. I understand now. My heart is not as pure as it was, I guess. Anyway, here's the revelation that was given to me by the Lord. You know, let me just, I dropped it on you a little bit, but I have to drop it on you again, because you're obviously that went in one ear and out the other. God, Revelation 18, you know, he said, and we read it today, you come out and be separate. Don't be partakers of her lusts and her sins, because she's about to be judged. So God is saying you don't want to be there when the thing comes down. Right? You don't want to be connected to that world system in any way, shape, or form when the angels start kicking butt. All by using people like terrorists and things like that to do their bidding. You don't want to be, well, those people that died, they're all innocent. Well, maybe not. The fact is, everyone in the United States has been put into fear. The funny thing about, you know, the screaming liberals on Twitter or screaming you should be killed and all these things that we would never be allowed to say, being of a conservative bent or being godly people. We wouldn't threaten people anyway, but I mean, if we did anything that they did, we would be arrested. So obviously the government supports their hate speech, supports the double standard, supports ISIS, and in fact scripts it. This whole thing was scripted, in my view. And then they go, well, ISIS didn't sanction it. Of course they don't sanction anything. Everything they do is scripted for them. They don't do anything on their own. You know, all the terror attacks are scripted for the maximum value, maximum social engineering value. But in this time of instability and violence, God is avenging using that very same thing that could bum you out. I mean, look, you could sit here and be really upset that, you know, look what's happening and nobody sees it and it could be a bloodbath. So really bad terror things are going to happen now, all the time, and you know, it's just an assault. No. God is doing what he's doing with it all. There are obviously people here that, after millions do die, and I have no doubt millions of Americans will die. They will start to wake up, but not really until then. They're not going to wake up now. They're having too much fun. But you see, there's just a little bit of a problem. These terror attacks have started to shake some of Obama's key supporters. Like, for example, studio moguls in Hollywood are concerned. Business leaders on Wall Street are concerned with what their president is doing, because they know, you know that they all know what's going on behind the scenes, don't you? That they play pretend in front of the media. They can't say what they know about, whether it be a 9/11, whether it be, you know, but they all know. I learned this from my mother. She says, look, they all know everything, that you're digging into something, or something that's called a conspiracy thing. They already know all that. But what they're doing is they're playing pretend. You know, and they're going to socially vilify you and shame you for looking into any of these things, because we're all supposed to play pretend. Don't you understand? We're not supposed to look into those things. We're supposed to just look the other way. And if you learn to do that, then, you know, you're going to have a good time in this world. And that was, you know, probably pretty dang good advice, if you ask me. I mean, if she's looking out for me and wanted me to do well in the world, she'd give me a little tip, you know, that everybody knows everything. Everyone, that's what she used to tell me when I was like, you know, 15 or so. Everyone already knows everything. You know, everyone's been abused, she would say. Everyone's had, you know, satanic ritual. It's everywhere. The amount of Satanists is, it's everyone, okay? It's everyone who wants to, you know, succeed. And nobody wants to admit any of this, and it all just stays secret because it's the, you know, because people don't want to talk about this, all these awful subjects. Now, you, son, that means me, get your mind around that and understand, you know, everybody knows, okay? So just kind of like when in Rome, come on now. You know, go along to get along. Just learn to play the game too, like they do, and you'll be just fine. I remember when there was that gal was, you know, when the last year my mother was alive, and that gal was gunned down near her house off Whittier Drive. It was actually, she was making a left turn off Sunset onto Whittier and to head down toward, there's a shortcut down to Wilshire Boulevard that way. And she was gunned down, well, she was actually shot right in the intersection by a guy who just decided to ride his bike to very quiet Beverly Hills corner, which is, it, Sunset's loud, but that time of the night would be very quiet. It's a residential area all the way around. And he just decided to ride from deep down in the bowels of Hollywood somewhere, of L.A., to ride 20 miles to just sit there and wait. And then when he saw a random car, he just went and shot her. Really? And then that Walsh guy came out, America's Most Wanted, and verified, yep, just a random shooting. Just happened to ride his bike all the way to that point. And if the police saw someone milling around on the corner there, I mean, it's dark on that corner, but, you know, obviously they wouldn't, you know what I mean? It was just like, what would he be doing 20 miles away from where he was lived or whatever, where he was homeless or whatever it was? Very strange, right? Well, all these are strange. You know, as my mother would tell me, you know, and then she made the left turn, and then as she was dying, she crashed into, her name was Ronnie Chasen. See, I remember. And she crashed into a light post, and the light post fell over the car, I believe. And I don't think she was robbed, or they tried to say it was a motive of robbery, but I'm not sure she was robbed, saying he got spooked, and then he rode his bike 20 miles through residential neighborhoods, down Sunset, down Santa Monica, down Beverly Boulevard, through all those signals at 1 or 2 in the morning, riding his bike all the way back to his seedy little place he was living in. Really? Why that corner? Why wait there? Because people are rich in Beverly Hills, they got money you can steal? Well, then why not steal something? He still had time. Anyway, so when Trish and I were out there, and there was like a wreath and a thing, you know, the light post was removed, and, you know, they had, like, people laid wreaths down where she had died, you know, in her Mercedes. And it's typical, like, Beverly Hills story. So, you know, you would think this would be news because my mother's house was, like, just off Sunset and back a little bit on a street called Greenleaf, or Greenway, rather, Greenway. It was right on the L.A. Country Club green as well. I think it was the ninth hole. So there was a view over that golf course to Century City in the background. It's very beautiful kind of view of the Century City towers through, but it was, gave the impression of almost being in the country. But this happened, this Whittier is like, you know, it's a half a block, you know, and I said, well, did you hear gunshots? I mean, did you hear, this is terrible. And she actually participated in the cover-up. She wouldn't deal with it with me. She actually just, I know what happened, you know, like she knew, and she refused to deal with it. She would not deal with it. It was like, so many things she would cover up Like she just wouldn't, like it was illegal for her to talk about it. Like it was only polite for her to participate in the cover up. I said, you know, they're covering up. They're trying to blame this guy and say it was, she goes, I know what it was. And that's, I don't want to talk about it. Boom. So indicating she knew what it was. And she didn't want to talk about it. And she went ahead and participated in the pretend, the game. And wanted me to do likewise. And I did because she was mad that it was even brought up as a topic. I said, but it just happened right over here. What's the... No, we don't talk about things like that. When things like that happen, we don't talk about it. So this is like being... Living here in high society here is like musical chairs. I mean, you don't know who's going to go next. Stuff like that happens all the time. Another person didn't deal with it. Jeff Bridges didn't deal with it, and Cher didn't deal with it, and nobody really dealt with it. They all covered it up, including the family of Ronnie Chasen. It was just a tragic, random event, and that was the end of it. They all participated in the cover-up, because you see, if any one of them decided to go to town and try to prove it was some sort of conspiracy, that would be the end of that paycheck. Don't ask me why, but my mother was like so automatic, you know. She died about a year after that, you know. She told me she wasn't going to die, and then she did. I've tried to understand it all, you know, but. You know, out in that rarefied society of Beverly Hills and entertainment and, you know, Sunset Boulevard and Holmby Hills and $30 million houses and all that stuff, or $100 million houses now, you know, and that, I understand the market's crashing now. It kind of was a big bubble, right? But in that whole world, you know, of, you know, Rodeo Drive and the restaurants and the you know, movies and the theaters and the music and the Sunset Boulevard, the Sunset Strip, and all the stuff that's all right there, you know, Beverly Hills Hotel and all this hoopla, whatever, all this, you know, and famous people living everywhere you look, you know what I mean, and they're all involved in all this entertainment and stuff, and that seems to be the main dominant thing is the entertainment industry in Beverly Hills anyway. Funny to watch them, to see when they just don't, when they drop a subject, like, you know, that would go against the paycheck. You could see that, but how, snap my fingers, because it's, I mean, automatic, boom, 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 like that, just trained seals, boom, you know, that subject doesn't exist, next please, you know. Ah, moving right along, you know what I mean? And they start laughing and moving on. You've never seen anything like it. And I had a vision. And I told her, it was a famous stylist that I knew, and she was getting kind of all on in years and probably going to be retiring, but I got mad at her, you know, and I said, you know, one day you're going to see Sunset Boulevard with just nothing but burned out buildings. You know, God's going to destroy it. And that's the last we ever spoke, of course, right? But she goes, oh, I didn't mean to get you upset. And it's like, it's not me that's upset. I'm just warning you that this thing is not a forever thing that you're enjoying driving around. And she had an Escalade or something, you know, and she would drive around and she really, you know, had these stupid rituals she would do and, you know, go out to, you know, whatever the famous bar was or the thing. And it was all about social climbing and she's gotten a little old to be chasing the boys, but, you know, who she slept with and, you know, who she went to a meeting with, you know, it's just like name dropping. And you know what I mean? I know I see you out there. There's somebody out in Hollywood Hills somewhere listening. So you guy, right? You can see almost beyond Sunset Boulevard, but you look out and you see the whole LA basin. What are you doing listening to this show? And what are you doing listening at 3 a.m? Is the Lord talking to you? See, because he's always shown me these visions of Los Angeles, you know, and even, you know, it's like, because LA, you know, I was aware that there's something underground there, you know, like lizards and stuff. I mean, just that are eating humans, you know, and I didn't say anything because that makes me sound like I'm completely insane. So I just kind of buried that, you know, but I was just aware that there's this weird thing with LA, you know, just, it's a hotbed for like all these cults, you know. You know, the Vedanta Society, which I used to hang out all the time when, you know, looking for the answers. And, you know, they, all these, you know, the Philosophical Research Society of Manly P. Hall and that whole library he had there, which was just all these ancient occult books that you couldn't get anywhere else. And they were in the library for people that were official scholars or approved of by the library. They'd let you take the book out and sit at a table and look at it there. And then it had to be carefully put back. And then you had the Theosophical Society was down on what street was that? Not La Brea, but it was on, I'm just trying to remember what street that was. What street is it that leads up to Griffith Park? It goes by the American Film Institute. Anyway, LA is a hotbed for all the cults, you know, the Krishna Society, the, you know, Krishnaism, the Bhagavad Gita Museum. Is there, you know, all the Zen, both schools of Zen, Rinzai and Soto, both are there. A hotbed for Eastern religion. It's really a, like a melting pot of all the different religions. You know, you have the famous Bodhi Tree bookstore and everything, New Age stuff, you know. That's where Marianne Williamson got her big start. It was, you know, she was on public access TV in Los Angeles because that's where Gene Scott got his start, on public access in LA. I used to watch all those public access shows. He would wear overalls, be like a country bumpkin, and he'd just sit there staring. Unless someone called up and donated, like, you know, some money to him, he would just stare at the camera. It was just amazing. It was the best TV I'd ever seen. Most entertaining stuff I'd ever seen is when no one would send any money. He would literally sit there for an hour just staring. He wouldn't say a word until someone paid him, and then he'd keep squawking. But you know, it's a hotbed of cults, you know, UFO cults and New Age cults, and it's just you have no idea. It's the most intense place spiritually in all the world. There's no place like it in all the world. You could go to any of these cities. You could go to Kathmandu if you like. You could go to just thinking places where there's lots of temples and things of Kathmandu and. No, it's nowhere even near the intent, the level of all the activity, you know, added up is really something. And you have lots of fake cult leaders, and you got right now that's really big on the UFOs. The whole center of the whole UFO thing is Los Angeles. And you got these women who are having sex with these aliens and telling people about how the hybrid children they're raising and how they get to hold the baby. And you know, there's always the same batch of young 20-something girls that are really pretty. And they talk about their experiences and what happens is they lure people in, right? Back when I was that age, you had the 20-year-old girls saying the same thing. And here they are still at it today. And you tell them to wake the F up, you know, that this is, again, an abomination, having sex with demons. And they absolutely say we're making a better world because one day these hybrids will be released. And they're peaceful, good people. And of course, there is a day like that coming. And that day is the triple helix DNA mark of the beast. And that is in the works too. In fact, I believe they already have that. And it's just a matter of rolling that. Just like they already have the guillotines, they already have this whole drama set up to be exactly what the Bible says. Not the sutras, not the Quran, not the ancient Sumerian text, not which were cuneiform, I believe, not the Egyptian text, the Egyptian Book of the Dead, not, and, you know, it's very clear. So the time we're in is this. While all this is going on, God is gathering and protecting and avenging His own. So He wants His children to be rejoicing at what you're going to witness. As you see the way things unfold, as you see some of this carnage, unfortunately, and I wish that none of us would have to see the kinds of things we just saw, and how it's been dealt with is more horrific than the thing itself. Amen? Amen? It's terrible what these people do, just awful. But you see, the signs of their undoing has come. The confusion in the ranks and the betrayals have come. The mismanagement of all this and the infighting in these agencies, they can't say anything publicly yet, but they're at it. They're at war right now with each other, has come. The complete unraveling of the Babylon world system has come. They've ridden high in the hog, high in the saddle, for a long time now, to the point where the saints, I testify before you, Lord, the saints have been worn out. Yes, I know that. Has come, a la the book of Daniel. It just seems, from everything I see, that if we're not at this kind of end point of this story, we are certainly in the end point of this civilization. You know, I am forbidden to put a time on it, but it feels like I'm in the middle of the time. And then we start talking about times, you know, time and a half and half a time or whatever, when we're talking about like a 3.5-year period, 7-year period, whatever. When we're talking about these short amounts of time where it looks like for like a 3.5-year period, well, my God, they can do no wrong, and they change all the laws, and they get their way, and they spray the White House with a rainbow thing because it's an abomination. I mean, it's. I'm sorry, I'm not against, you know, I'm not against gay people at all. You know, that's not, you didn't understand what I'm talking about. I'm talking about the Bible here, and I'm talking about the motivation of the New World Order and what the Satanists are trying to do. I'm sorry if you're offended. If you're offended with them using the gay marriage issue, then you should be offended with them. They're the ones using it for a different purpose than what you think it's for. You think it's for liberating all the old prejudices against gay people and making it normal so that gay people can live happy lives. I understand that, but that's not what they're doing. That's what you're asleep on, but one day you'll understand. Whether you marry, have a ceremony in a church with a same-sex person or not, you're going to one day understand. It doesn't matter what you think anyway. It matters what is, not your opinion of it. What is not changed by your opinion. I'd make a funny statement. If I went the gay route, I probably wouldn't be here right now, but if I had, last thing I'd want to do is get married. You know, the whole point of it is to be, you know, is rebellion against all that. So there's some sinister thing going with this marriage, and it's, to me, it's getting people to accept, you know, and then you may kiss the bride, and then having everyone truly love it. And, you know, people are uncomfortable, but we need to get them very comfortable, and that's the New World Order. You know, and I'm sorry to pick on that issue, but I mean, that's a good issue to pick on because gay people have been deceived into thinking that they're getting liberated and equality, and people are not going to be prejudiced against them anymore. Well, I'm not prejudiced against you, and I don't care if you get married. I'm just telling what they're trying to, from their perspective, what they're trying to do with it. And let's talk about abortion or any of these other issues. There's a reason behind it all. It's to get us to accept everything that is anti-Christ as normal. Everything that is anti-common sense as normal. What they're really doing now, I mean, what they want the late-term abortions for is so they can have tissue for the life extension technologies. They need the tissue for that, and that's promised to the elites, that they will be able to live, you know, into hundreds and even perhaps thousands of years. Or more, with a combination of bionics, stem cell, you know, live tissue, and various other things. A case in point of, this is just a hearsay rumor, but apparently someone was on the plane with David Bowie, and he looked like his skin, they said, looked almost translucent, like baby skin, and what's he doing? And apparently he was dipping into that same research.
It's legal. It's not illegal for him to do that. That kind of therapy. It's some illegalities in the United States, but I'm sure there's clinics and places where they buy baby parts and they aid with this life extension of your cells and organs and, you know, give you that reboot. I saw him on Palladia and he looked like he was, you know, 28 years old. It was shocking. I thought it was like an old tape from 1978 or something, but no, it was today. And it was horrifying. But I mean, you know, it's that life extension stuff is going on, and it's offered to entertainers because they help to mind control all of you. You know, they help to destroy your lives, and they did destroy you. Because look, all you are is like a parrot TV brain. All you say is just what you've been programmed to say. Your own thoughts, you don't even have your own thoughts. You just mimic what you hear and see on television. You know, what is that? What kind of life? I don't get that. But, you know, they pay the entertainers huge amounts of money because they've helped to keep you in Parrotville. That's why I was making the whole joke about Tom Petty trying to lull us into our graves, you know, with Nostalgia Man. Nostalgia Man, Tom Petty, flying bagels and cream cheese, get into your coffin. Not so fast, dude. Nope, I don't think I'll go gently into that good night. Because, I mean, I may be older. But, you know, you can hear my spirit. There is no age. You know what I mean? I could be hanging out with 15-year-old, 25-year-old, 35-year-old. You know, my spirit is my spirit. My spirit is really what dictates my countenance, what dictates my words, what dictates everything. So, anyway, so what we're supposed to do in this time is, instead of being filled with dread and worry and pain and doubt and upset, we're supposed to be rejoicing as we see these things coming to pass. And I know that sounds completely counterintuitive, you know what I mean? Because I've violated that. I've been feeling dread, you know, and you can hear it reflected in some of my music and stuff. And, you know, I'm working hard on this track right now. Not working hard. I mean, I'm playing hard, you know, on this track. It's really cool. I'm working on with fellow collaborator, and you know, I was really happy to have, you know, rediscovered guitar, and now I'm, you know, starting to get better at it, and I'm playing bass in there, and there's like two, he's playing bass too. We've got basses, we got three different bass parts, and a couple different guitar parts, and it's just really been great, the kinds of tones and vibes I could get, you know. This thing is kind of a modern electronic piece, but again, the guitar can fit perfectly in there. And, you know, the synth is not feeling, it's not putting me where this is a very psychological piece, you know, very ambient and psychological, it takes you somewhere, you know. So different kinds of sounds do different things emotionally. And so it's really a sonic kind of thing. But hey, those of you who kind of went through my analog thing of the last couple of tracks where I was, you know, I can do virtuoso stuff on keyboards, but I mean, yeah, I'm playing guitar, just kind of basic like a garage band, and bass and drums, and then having a good production out of it. Keeping some of the mistakes in, you know, editing old-fashioned way, editing audio, not editing MIDI notes, and you know, it paid off. You know, there's something real about it, you know, and I got kind of depressed after the last track, but I think it's because, you know, it felt futile, you know, that the thing that what I was singing about in the track, it was very, you know, searching and not finding kind of thing, you know, it's kind of sort of disappointment upon disappointment, you know, things not working out quite, but now I'm into more crazy stuff. Like, okay, it's actually insane right now. It's actually completely insane, completely unstable.
They're going to pull the puppet out, Obama, to do his little speech thing today, the marionette, who they have to hold up with. They have to add extra strings to him now because he himself is, like, probably feeling out of control himself. It's amazing how they ruthlessly march toward this goal of theirs and don't give a damn about who it hurts, who they betray, about starving children, about, you know, people being gunned down. And to them, it's just all okay. Loretta Lynch, one of the coldest people ever in the history of the entire world, actually, coming out just like a female version of a Joseph Stalin and saying, we're with you, Muslims. I mean, that's her condolence to the victims of this tragic event. And so you had some people rebelling and saying, you know, it's like this, Loretta. You know what? Screw the Muslims. We need to go to war with them and kill them all. You know what I mean? And then they're saying, so go ahead and arrest me. And this is what George Pataki said that, and there's another guy. There's a bunch of people saying something like that. I'm not saying anything like that. I'm looking at it differently. I don't really feel a. I'm not quite sure. You know, I'm looking at it differently. I look at the Muslim thing more like a government psyop. You know, and less like some kind of force to be reckoned with, other than. You know, we have the most powerful government here in the United States ever, and if they're behind that, then you know, that's what you're dealing with. I'm kind of looking behind the scenes, and because I also, you know, feel sorry for the Muslims, because they're coddling them now. The left is, you know, the left, the globalist left, coddling them now. But the idea ultimately is, you know, they'll be thrown under the bus once they use them, you know, once they're done with their purpose, which is to be the proxy battering ram to get their new world order in. And so that's why the immigration and everything, it's the invasion basically, you know, they want to break American pieces, and they're going to bring people here to do that, but they're kind of reluctant right now because people are armed. And if they could just get the guns, so they're going to have these false flag attacks like every week and every other day, you know, more and more shootings and things. So they can finally get the guns, and then they can really bring them in, you know what I mean, at that point. And then they can, you know, finish the job. And a funny thing happened on the way to all this. It's just going into chaos. And Obama and his people that control him, they can't control it. So get your popcorn, saddle on up to the ringside seat, and enjoy. You know, it's not a big revelation, guys. You know, it's just the Lord was straightening me out, and I'm sharing it with you. He is saying that he's avenging, you know, the hurt that's been done to his children. And, you know, there's a time in every generation where there is that, you know, they feel like with the innocence they can just tread all over them. They'll never do anything. They don't have a voice. It's okay. This is a free target practice. It doesn't matter if you mow them down or not. You know, and now, you know, the people that thought they were going to have this new world based on equality and overthrow the system and have this other system in place for them right away and have this lovely world of tolerance and PC values and whatnot, they're in for a very, very rude awakening, because the bloodbath that's coming doesn't know any boundaries, like don't touch these people or those people. So they're going to be going down. You know, instead of being on Twitter one day, they'll be gone. If there's an EMP attack, most Americans, you know, like a lot of people in the world, will die, because they'll starve to death, basically. And, you know, all of this is hanging in the balance right now, all of it, including World War III nukes, EMP attack taking down the grids, which would then stop any food supply from going wherever it needs to go. So you would basically not have any, you know, if you prepped, then you'd have your MREs or whatever you've got. You know, but the calculation is that about 80 or 90% of the American people would die. without the infrastructure based on the whole digital electric realm, right? The grid. And, you know, they do things to hurt the grid and diminish the grid and take power off the grid and shut down the grid to make it more likely for a breakdown. The people then, therefore, that are rulers over you are sick, you see, because they're preying upon you for their power. And the ruler that does that is the ruler that's going to be out of a job pretty soon. Because without you, they have no way to rule. They have no reason for their existence. And so all of this is the movement of God right now. Meaning, it's not about what they want. It's about what God's doing. And what he's doing is avenging his children. While they're trying to avenge all the wrongs they think have been done, they're being they're not getting their way. It's more, the focus is shifted. They're the bad guys. And they were supposed to be the champions of social justice. Well, that's not what's on the docket right now. Prophetically, what's on the docket is what may look like chaos and mayhem and confusion and, you know, terrorism, death. And right now, they're going to have to shift the focus back to Putin, Syria, the global war, because the failure of domestic policy, just like the failure of international or foreign policy, is not something this president can handle. Because they're supposed to prop him up for the legacy and the libraries. I mean, he's just in it for that stuff. He's passed laws that are against God. Okay, big deal. That's nothing I'd be proud of. He's made the economy so that it wouldn't grow. So it's just sort of like he could take credit for 5% unemployment when 95 million people are out of work, a record number. See what I mean? It's double. Everything he does is double, right? That's why everyone goes, oh, he's so smart. No, he's deceptive. There's a difference between smart and deceptive. If he were smart, he would do those things which would ensure his own sustenance. He has not lived like that. He's ensured his own destruction. And, you know, and the ship is already starting to sink. In terms of, you know, the anger is coming on the whole. Because he'll go out and he'll say, America's safe now. You can have your Thanksgiving dinner. Go ahead. You know, I saw yesterday we said you couldn't fly, but today you can fly. And then, of course, we have the shooting, right? ISIS is contained. Then, boom, Paris. So he's lost all credibility, you know, and it's just from here, I don't see it recovering. I see him going down that. It's almost supernatural how he's misspeaking because he prides himself on such careful speech, such careful wording. But everything he says, you know, it's almost like if someone trying to do him in, it's like if someone trying to wreck his credibility, he says everything's safe and then some awful thing happens. Yes, Australia had put out a warning about traveling to the United States. They are very wise in that and they should keep that in place. It's not safe to travel here right now. The United States is not safe. I repeat, the United States is not safe. There's a war going on between federal agencies and within an interagency as well, within the FBI, the CIA, the Pentagon, you can see that already from the mixed news briefings. Obviously, in the White House, the State Department, and the big billionaire backers of these politicians, they're all at war with each other right now. That's why the Putin thing was wiped off the map for now. Because it was so mishandled by Obama. They're trying to get people to forget that Putin kicked his ass. You have the weakest of weak, of weak, weak, weak. But then, by design, it's like, yes, I'm weak and making things change for the worse for America because of that feign, but it's really a strategy, they'll say. It's like, okay, but that strategy is now impinging upon who? The very people in the milieu, in the culture of running things. And because they're at war with each other, Obama more and more looks like a deer in the headlights because he doesn't know if he's going to get out of this thing. He's in doubt as to whether anyone survives. And you can see it. You can feel it. To check him out when he's talking so confident. Things like this don't happen in other countries. And I think we should do something about it because make it harder to get guns so things like this won't happen in the future. And I'll, as president, commander-in-chief, I'll do what I can to make America safer so these things don't happen anymore. We're going to have full-time screening of by psychiatrists of every single person, a test for each and every person to see if they're mentally stable. And, you know, if they're not, then we're going to label them so they cannot get a gun. And so anybody that has a philosophy different from theirs would immediately be on the list, the no-gun list. Just like there's a no-fly zone thing, there'll be a no-gun zone. And no-fly list, no-gun list. And it'll be based on, like, the no-fly list, just based on make it up as you go along, just people you don't like. And that level of corruption that everyone knows about and everyone sees, people are sick and tired of it, okay? Sick and tired of it. They yearn. America being more and more sullied and dirtied around the world, laughed at, completely laughed at, mocked, laughing stock, totally. And these people put their noses up in the air proudly, like they're proud to be American now, and that this is the best president of their lifetime since Quentin Tarantino and lots of other people on Twitter thinking this is a great place. If only we didn't have conservatives or libertarians or white people or, you know, Christians or whatever, then we could have a really great place. No, it wouldn't exist. Well, places have existed before. Pagans live all over the world. What are you talking about? This particular place was founded on the grace of God, on the power of the Almighty, on prayer. You take that away and you don't have the original intent, won't be here. So that's all I really have to say today. I mean, you know, it's we are to look at it differently as we see these attacks and these things intensify. Now, today, I believe that the Obama is going to do everything in his power, but he doesn't have much in the way of political capital credibility when he speaks anymore. But he'll muster up his best oratory skills to basically let you know that things are safe, and he and his staff and the FBI and the various agencies are working tirelessly to make sure Americans are safe and have nothing to worry about. Because they realize his own people now are rattled, you see. It's seeped into them. The fear has crept in. And so it's coming, it's like a noose around his neck. He's got to say something. As to whether people will feel assured or not, as to whether that whatever Obama says, could there be more terror? I think they'll cool it for a bit, you know, they're their own worst enemy. They're going to need more terror in order to get done what they want to get done. So it's just a terrible, you know, we're in a terrible spot here, you know, and I could see ahead to where there is actually a time of peace. But from here to there's a tough road to hoe right here. And the lambs are supposed to just look at this as God turning the tables. God's turning the tables. Those people that were smug and living deliciously and so confident, America was finally a decent place now that we've gotten rid of God and we got these various, you know, abominations and blah, blah, blah. It's finally a place that looks like it's, you know, we got the minimum wage and we're going to have equality and it looks like a place that's going to be a place I'd be proud of. And right at that point of pride and arrogance, and hubris, the rug's being pulled out. Because, you know, a house is divided. If you betray everybody that trusts you, Obama has a habit of doing this. I don't know exactly that's what I get kind of in the spirit, you know, so I see that. At a time like this, he's not going to have many friends. And that's what you need at a time like this, you know, support, right? You know, and right now it's chaos. So they're going to roll him out and make him say, you know, make him do a good speech, you know, to assure Americans and the rest of the world that we're going to be on top of it next time. Just, you go about your business, go about your Christmas shopping, it's okay. Not going to happen again. And the reason that they can assure you of that is because the only one that could actually assure you of that is people who are actually running all that stuff. I mean, right? How can they guarantee? People are going to do what they want to do, right? They want to attack, they'll attack. No, it seems they attack at strategic moments. Strategic for whom, though? And this is the big problem. You know, what side is Obama on? I think most people would say, well, he's on the other side. He's a traitor. He's against the American people. He's for anything but America. Yes, that's exactly what he's put forth. That's exactly the way he's behaved and what he has said have led to that conclusion. The facts on the ground speak to that is what most Americans think. And they're sick of it and they want, you know, John Wayne. That's why Trump's popularity is so huge right now, because people are just so completely sick of this sort of sycophantic cult of personality, Obama, the left, PC correctness, police, the shootings, and the whole thing is ugly and horrible. And what these people should have realized is all these false flags, like Paris and the rest of it, they leave a stink. So the people are not behaving the way you want them to, because there's a stink. There's justice that needs to be done here. The truth needs to come out. So if it doesn't, there's a big stink on it all. Just like there's a big stink on 9/11. There still is. And it makes it so that you can't do anything that you want to do, a la the social engineering. People are not behaving the way that the models had predicted. So there's more trouble. They want you to go back to the mind control, back to your rituals, back to your placid little lives, and go do your routines. And then they'll hit you again later when you least expect it, thinking they'll get the result they want then. But that day will never come because there's a stink already that never goes away. And the more of these events that happen, the more stink there is, because the truth never comes out. There's such a lack of credibility, a credibility gap, that there's actually a vacuum in leadership, which means they can't get their way with the people because the people don't buy it. Even the people on the left, well, they'll nod, wink, they're with you, but really they're worried now too. And that's why the speech has to be today, because the worry of his own people, people they think they've got under control, their fear and worry is blowing it. Not anticipated. They're supposed to be confident that they're getting justice, truth, equality, unity, togetherness, and all those wonderful things. They're finally getting a world without racial prejudice, without, with tolerance for people and their different lifestyles, and, you know, with more love and more harmony between people, more understanding, that it's all good. And indeed, that's how they bring the whole thing in. It's on truth, unity, togetherness, tolerance, equality, and that's how the Luciferian way is brought in, of course. But, you know, and there may be a backlash against saints in response to what Yahweh is doing, because they have soothsayers and things who are plotting against the Lord, who are saying, well, now he's doing this. All I'm saying is, yes, God is doing what he's going to do, but he very much loves his children, and the people that have been harmed have, you know, someone behind them. You're not all alone out there. I know you feel very meek, very powerless, very lonely, like nobody has your back, like you're just bedraggled. You, saint, are one of the ones that the Bible talks about in the book of Daniel. You've been worn out, haven't you? I have been worn out. We've been worn out from this battle that we face every day, you know, battling out on the internet or however we do it, you know, the shunning, the rejection. I get it every day. I get it in music sometimes. I collab with somebody and then they find out who I am and then it's weird, you know what I mean? And then eventually rejected. And yeah, I mean, that happens, you know, come on the show and I go on the show and say what I got to say and then I get booted off for having said what he said. Said what you have to say. I said what I got to say and then I'm booted off for what I said. It's like a million incidents like the movie Carrie. You're brought in, you think, hey, it's okay now. I'm getting somewhere now. I'm going to convince these people that the Lord's the way to go. And that, but really, you know, of what reality is, I'm going to convince them. To wit, I've only convinced the choir. I've only convinced the choir. And the choir already knew. As far as the worlders and the churches and the church system, God will reform that through pain. If you're in there and you know better, then you better come out now would be the time. Because we just dropped on you Revelation 18, and that says, come out from among them and be separate. Make sure that you're not, because she's about to be judged. Make sure you're not there when that judgment comes down, okay? All right? Fair warning? I'm giving you a warning right out of the Bible. Fair warning, guys? Now is the time to come out and be separate. Let the Lord bring you out from there because she's about to be judged. Well, I'm not saying to not go to your jobs or anything. I'm not saying that. No. I'm not saying to drop out of society even. It's a spiritual thing. You know, if you're not really in it, not of it, I mean, if you know, you've got to get right with Jesus Christ. That's what I mean. That's all I mean. That's it. That's 100% of what I mean. Everybody that tries to do separation, you know, sannyasin, I told you, those sannyasins weren't lambs. It's like, they've renounced the world, Zeph. Yeah, but they're not lambs. I'm sorry. You know, they can pretend they renounce the world all they like. They never renounce the world, is my point. You know, it's not something you have to make a show of. Like, I got to go to this ashram and give up all my worldly possessions to prove that I have renounced the world. And then I come along and go, you're still part of the world, dude. You're still in the world system. This theatrical show you've just done means nothing. It's just materialism. You know, the only way you can be separate from all this is the Lord has to do it. It's a spiritual event in your life. It's called the baptism by fire. And only the Lord can give you that. And those of us who've had that, we know who we are. I mean, we all you know, nod and wink too and get along and, you know, we all communicate almost telepathically, you know. It's just the weirdest thing. But the baptism by fire is also the rite of separation. And it's a legal separation from the contract that obviously Satan has when we come into the world to dominate our lives or to, you know, to try to convince, you know, whatever it is, this harvesting thing, this whole thing that goes on with people's lives. You know, they want something from you, right? So you're like a little crop that's come up from the ground and then they want to harvest you, but they can't do it without your consent, right? And they get power off of it, but they can't do it without your consent, right? One way of getting your consent without having to really get your consent is to have you doing abominations as normal in the sight of the Lord, as if you're in good stead. Not looking over your shoulder, you don't believe that anything bad's going to happen to you. We have had decades of abominations, of absolute, you know, just an absolute abject war on God. We've had probably the worst spiritual warfare in history has been here in the last 50 years. You know, all about separating people from the love of God and doing it through, you know,
other religions, things, you know, getting away from all the principles that made America great in the first place. You know, sacrifice, principles, you know, morals, honor, tradition, meaning, you know, Judeo-Christian values, the Bible, law, innovation, you know, the people not feeling like everyone's separate from everyone else, but a feeling of unity, which we had prior to World War II. It's why we were able to come together to do something with that, because people felt more of a sense of unity with one another. That's completely gone now, and there's no decorum. People are not nice. They insult each other, call each other names on Twitter, you know. People used to be the honorable so-and-so is now some POS, blah, blah, blah. And you know, I mean, I get mad and say names too, and I'm sorry. But I mean, we never used to be like this. And I've obviously been like this too, but we were never like this before. Respect was given for the office of, you know, people might not like, say, Jimmy Carter when he was there. He was just like, people couldn't wait to get rid of him. It's a very similar thing that's going on now with Obama. And, but still there wasn't that kind of loss of decorum there. There was, you know, private conversation of what a moron he is, but it wasn't, you know, public, like social media wasn't around, but it wasn't on the news or people didn't have, you know, I mean, these are private conversations and that's the way it used to be. But now it's like your private conversations are out all over Twitter and everywhere else. So everyone is a POS. Everyone is a pejorative term. Everyone hates everyone. Everyone is filled with misery in America. People are completely dreading their lives and feeling like there's no hope for them. And these are people that had followed Obama. And they're the ones that need to be ministered to today. He's not speaking to us today, you know, the people that are obviously following the Lord. He's speaking to the people that followed him who are so amazingly disappointed and scared to death. They are scared to death at you know, what the president is doing. They feel betrayed. And so he's trying to shore up his base and people that had their faith in him. You know, because there's another election coming up, and it's very much in doubt whether there will be one or not. It just depends on between now and November if they can get in January, really, the next January, 2017, whether they can, whether the international war goes hot, whether they, you know, whether violence against people through proxy and deception is going to be acceptable. It's just an awful vibe. An awful feeling, Lord, just an awful feeling in America, an awful feeling of such betrayal and such criminality and such cheapening of life, Lord, that nobody cares about human life anymore. It's just people die, carnage on the news. They don't, it's, you know, off to get a popsicle. It's all the same thing now. Death and life have become utterly profane, not sacred. Respect for elders, for anyone, out the window. Barbarism has replaced education. All this, of course, was predicted, that the left would do all this. We had The Handmaid's Tale, we had George Orwell, we had all of it, where all this leads. To degradation, compartmentalization, enslavement, starvation, internment, lack of human rights, lack of quality nutrition, the end of education, the end of industry, the end of productivity, the end of the economy. So they're weighing it. Then the John Wayne people are out there saying, and this is really going to a bigger revelation, we're just not going to give up and let these people run roughshod. If we have to have World War III to stop them, by God, we will. I mean, I don't want to attack America, but if I have to, I will, says Vladimir Putin. I will. If it comes to that and they want a shooting war, then we'll have to, because we're defending Jesus Christ. So, well, Vlad's a New World Order guy. It's like, well, I wouldn't be so sure about that right now. God's using him. I can see it. If you can't, then, you know, c'est la vie. But I also see how God's using Trump in the same way. And I'm just amazed by those two things. And so they never anticipated such... And behind them are millions and millions and millions and millions and maybe even billions of people who want something different and don't want this whole thing to just go willy-nilly into the grave and don't want to go gently into that good night with all their entertainment and, you know, bread and circus, who don't want to just give up and say, okay, go ahead and cut my head off. Who are willing to fight for a better life. And at the same time, we have the specter of God's judgment upon all of it, which in today you can see in full force. Watch the conference. I think you're going to be amazed at that. Watch how it does nothing. It mollifies no one and nothing. And then I'll see you. Then I'll see you. Well, you know, I don't rejoice over people being harmed. I never have been like that. Like, you know, when someone gets harmed that had hurt me before, I don't celebrate that. I knew their day was coming because they were going around picking on people and stuff, and I knew that's wrong. I picked on people when I was very young. You know, just being young and a kid, and I got my comeuppance, I mean, and then some. But I got punished for it by the Lord, by karma, by I reaped what I had sown, and then I stopped being like that. I mean, I used to, like when we were kids, we'd be judging girls and who was hotter, and there'd be the fat girl, and, you know, people pick on the fat girl. Then I had weight issues, you know what I mean? And then it's like, oh my God, I got my comeuppance there too, didn't I? So, you know, you got to be careful the way you conduct your life. And, you know, if I live my life, you know, mocking, you know, then I'm going to be mocked too. God doesn't let us get away with stuff. I mean, the only thing we can really do is say, Lord, here I am. Please take me. Please guide me. Please give me rest. Please give me hope. Please help me to be with you. Help me. I can't take it anymore. I just need to be with you, Lord. And, you know, he loves that. You know, if it has to get to the point where you have no hope and no options out there, where this is about the end of the line for you, and you finally give it up, you finally break down before you finally say, take me, Lord. You finally say, there's nowhere else for me. You finally get it. He gets all that unconditional love from you, and you receive it from him. He waits. Sometimes it takes disastrous human circumstances before that love can be, you know, received and given. How much better is it for that saint of God to give that to him now, when there is no calamity? Thank you. And with that, I bid you many blessings and protection. And Lord would lift up your mood and a more of a feeling of joy rather than this dread that's come over this whole nation. That dread is not for you, brethren. Not for you. The dread is for the people who have done evil, who have felt that the ends justify the means, that who have lied and done and broken laws in order to effect this change, and who've had nefarious plans for people and even death of people in order to get their way. And even though they haven't really gone forward with all the death and destruction and mayhem, they're being punished for it
anyway. And so I'm just going to watch, just like you. I urge you to watch the news. You know, watch what happens, because I think you're going to see some surprises. I think we will. But anyway, every day has been a surprise lately, amen? So I'll see you next time.